Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. Thank you, Ricky, for that generous introduction. Thank you, Tikvah, above all, for being such a wonderful force for good in Israel, as well as, of course, in other parts of the world. Tikvah, well, Bill and I are only two of the many, many speakers who've been invited here and who've had the opportunity to experience Israel's exhilarating, invigorating politics and society and culture, your hospitality, and above all, your friendliness, your liveliness, your intellectual excitement. So it's a huge privilege to be here, and thank you very much for inviting me. So here we go. The right, the left, and the future of the West. Western civilization is threatened by an unprecedented array of external adversaries and dangers, ranging from Islamist terror and Russian or Chinese aggression to the fallout from failed states. It also faces internal threats, above all the collapse of confidence in Judeo-Christian values and democratic capitalism. What solutions do liberals and conservatives have to offer in answer to this predicament? Can either the left or the right rise to the challenge of the present crisis? Or are both traditions, both political traditions, mired in self-destructive mindsets that prevent them from grasping the scale of the task, let alone reversing the decline of the West? In this talk, I shall sketch a diagnosis and propose a cure for these pathologies of left and right, but I can only hazard a guess as to whether our political class is ready to take its medicine in time to save the day. The future of Western civilization will depend on how well the present can mobilize the intellectual resources of the past. I want to begin with the right, because the crisis of conservatism on both sides of the Atlantic seems too deep to be explained by the vagaries of individual personalities or parties. The example that most obviously illustrates this comes from America, where the fiasco of the Republican nomination is fresh in our minds. How could one of the oldest political parties in the world, drawing on the vast pool of talent provided by a great nation of more than 300 million souls, end up with Donald Trump? I will suggest three reasons, which I have discussed at greater length in an article in the April issue of Standpoint. Well, there's the Donald as the Tower of Trumpery, the Tower of Babel. First, the revolt of the masses, a phenomenon first analyzed by Ortega y Gasset, the great Spanish philosopher, in 1930, made it possible for a demagogue to appeal over the heads of the elites to the most plebeian and philistine instincts, the lowest moral common denominators. On the American right, we see the mastery of mediocrity, the apotheosis of the average, the triumph of trumpery, a word that ever since Shakespeare has denoted something showy but worthless, empty or ridiculous talk and deception. Those are the three dictionary meanings of the word trumpery. Second, the backlash against political correctness, a pathology that has spread from the universities via the social media to permeate every nook and cranny of society. That backlash has found its champion in Donald Trump. He is certainly not the sophisticated critic of illiberal liberalism that conservatives should wish for. Indeed, he is quite illiberal himself. But he has captured the field by shooting from the hip, indiscriminately targeting feminists, Hispanics, Muslims, just about anybody else who gets in his way. Indeed, well, there's someone sitting right here who's just got in his way, and he's getting targeted. Indeed, Trump may even have given political correctness a new lease of life by reminding people why it originally emerged. Third, Trump may appeal to the masses by denouncing the liberal elites who have failed America. But he belongs to those elites in a particular way. He is the embodiment of that culture of narcissism diagnosed by Christopher Lash in the 1970s, when Trump's mindset was formed. In an America where narcissists flourish, a reality TV host is a plausible president. The French Revolution ended by crowning a war hero as emperor. The American mutiny may end by inaugurating a megalomaniac as commander-in-chief, a paranoid, narcissistic megalomaniac. The strange case of Donald Trump illustrates the neglect of conservative thought. Such a thing has never entered his head. From Edmund Burke to William Buckley, from Samuel Johnson to Paul Johnson, from Irving Kristol to Bill Kristol, the confluence of dispositions and ideas we call conservatism has cumulatively inundated the politics of the English-speaking peoples, leaving traces and sediments in the theory and practice of almost every leading statesman. Yet the mind of Donald Trump is, as far as anybody can ascertain, an idea-free zone. He has a slogan, America First, but it is a tainted one. Either he is unaware of Charles Lindbergh's vile anti-Semitic campaign under that banner to stop the United States fighting Nazi Germany, in which case his ignorance of history is shocking, or he does not care, which is actually sinister. The Trump campaign has cooked up the most unpalatably putrid stew of nativism, protectionism, and paleoconservatism, served up as a patriotic dish for the populace. The worst, that is, since Huey Long tried to use Louisiana as a springboard for the White House in 1935. His public works projects, such as the Mexican Wall, are an echo, perhaps a conscious one, of Roosevelt's New Deal. But Trump's New Deal would, for all his vaunted skill in constructing towers, be built on sand, a ballooning debt that would be a bad investment for future generations. His would clearly be an activist, interventionist administration, except in foreign policy, where he advocates a crude form of realpolitik, the opposite of the Bush doctrine of defending freedom and democracy. He despises NATO members and America's Far Eastern allies as parasites. He has an unhealthy admiration for Putin and Xi Jinping, unaware of the usually disastrous denouement of dalliances between democracies and dictators. On the Middle East, he veers between professions of loyalty to the Jewish people and ominous intimations that he will force Israel to submit to one of his deals with the Palestinians. Nothing he has said on the subject suggests that he has the faintest notion of the complexities of the region. The best that can be hoped for is that he will make good on his promise to crush ISIS, but his pathological aversion to intervention rules that out. Despite having consulted Henry Kissinger, he is anything but a realist. He simply wants the rest of the world to leave America alone. It won't. Republicans rarely win without a unifying candidate. But even the most extreme cult of the personality cannot resurrect a defunct ideology from the graveyard of history. Both living Republican presidents, Bush, père et fils, have declined to endorse Trump. House Speaker Paul Ryan commented, "We hope that our nominee aspires to be Lincoln and Reagan-esque." Not only does Trump fall dismally short of that standard of statesmanship, he does not obviously belong in the same party as the best Republican presidents. But instead of rising to Ryan's challenge, he has allowed his supporters to blackmail the speaker. Trump's promise to exclude Muslims from entering the US, a process that implies imposing a religious test, was prima facie unconstitutional. Indeed, he has backed away from what he now says was just a suggestion. But such a lack of gravitas in matters so grave is a serious disqualification for a commander-in-chief. Islam's challenge to the values of the West is grave, but it does not require us to jettison those values in the name of national security. Trump is not so much Reagan-esque as Kafka-esque. Whatever now happens to the Trump campaign, forces have been unleashed that cannot easily be laid to rest again. It does not help that he has been consistently underestimated. A year ago, I recall being told by an old friend of his that, quote, Donald does not seriously want the presidency, unquote. Then the mantra was that his campaign would implode. When that did not happen, the line was that even if he won the nomination, his unpopularity among key demographics meant that he stood no chance against Hillary. Now the polls show that she is even more unpopular than he is. The pollsters, the commentariat, and yes, the editors of conservative magazines, like us, are dumbfounded. One Washington insider, John Hulsman, must stand for countless others who keep getting it wrong. Mr. Hulsman, who's an admirer of Lawrence of Arabia, evidently has plenty of time for charlatans, but still thinks that Trump will lose and that his ideology will die with him. Quote, so Trumpism, while rightfully smashing the feckless neoconservative elites that ran the GOP into the ground, is not the answer to what ails the Republican Party, unquote. Now, as a corresponding member of that feckless elite, I am struck by the way in which neocons are always blamed for whatever goes wrong on the American right. The last time the GOP took neocons' advice seriously, George W. Bush won twice. So, listen to the neocons. Conservatives have a choice between measured restraint and outright repudiation. Those who hope to restrain the candidate are banking on his need to make peace with the Republican establishment. Yet voters have already rejected the latter, whom they suspect of betraying and looting the Republic. Trump is their champion. Repudiation is not attractive either. It risks a permanent schism that might spread from the party to the people. In the absence of a deus ex machina, the Republicans are now stuck with Donald Trump. So, quite possibly, will be America and the West. It may be time for European leaders to come to terms with this phenomenon. There is very little to be gained by treating Trump as a pariah, as David Cameron has done, a short-sighted tactic which plays into the hands of isolationist sentiment. Better far to reach out to his supporters and reassure them of Britain's loyalty as an ally. If the right is struggling to appeal to voters who doubt the good faith of its conventional politicians, the left has the opposite problem. The same electorate that doubts whether slick conservatives mean what they say also fears that bearded socialists might indeed say what they mean. My example here comes from Britain. Jeremy Corbyn, the Che Guevara of North London, now leader of Her Majesty's loyal opposition. In comparison with his Brooklyn-born counterpart, Bernie Sanders, Corbyn comes off emphatically second best. Almost as badly educated and inarticulate as Trump, Corbyn lacks the natural eloquence of Sanders that has enabled the Vermont senator to run Hillary Clinton so close in this race. But Corbyn is no less popular than Sanders with a privileged and vociferous section of the young. By promoting their interests, such as free tuition, combined with much talk of inequality and injustice at home and abroad. The basic repertoire has not changed in nearly half a century. But the old tunes have found new audiences on both sides of the Atlantic. Not large enough to win elections, but quite enough to recommence the long march through the institutions that has carried the Corbyns and Sanderses further than Gramsci ever imagined. The anti-Western ideology that new left academics such as Noam Chomsky were peddling in the 1960s is still being peddled by Noam Chomsky. They're still at it. The Cold War may have ended more than a quarter of a century ago, but a war of ideas against the West is still being waged by the Marxists and their fellow travelers with undiminished ferocity. Corbyn, whose public utterances are scripted for him, by the former Guardian columnist Seamus Milne, an unrepentant Stalinist, not just a communist, I mean, he actually defends Stalin. Anyway, Corbyn appears to be untroubled by the genocidal role of the ideology he espouses during the last century. Like the Bourbons, he has learnt nothing and forgotten nothing. Like Robespierre, the sea-green incorruptible, he believes that he himself is the people. Anyone who doubts that is a traitor. But the cadaverous Corbyn is already being eclipsed by the new mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, who also hails from the far left, but is well aware of what is needed to woo middle-class voters who have much to lose by penal taxation and are deterred by socialist slogans. The fact that Khan has associated himself with 57 varieties of Islamist extremist does not preclude him from following Tony Blair's electoral playbook. It may be hard to imagine Jeremy Corbyn entering Downing Street as Britain's first Marxist Prime Minister. It is not at all hard to imagine Sadiq Khan there as our first Muslim one. He has successfully rewritten the narrative of how he won the mayoralty by a broad appeal to Londoners of all ethnic and religious stripes, defeating a vicious Islamophobic campaign by the Conservative candidate Zach Goldsmith, who highlighted Khan's Islamist links. That's his narrative. The truth is rather different. The Conservative vote actually held up well, falling by only 60,000 compared to Boris Johnson's winning total of 970,000 in 2012. But Sadiq Khan's vote hugely increased by more than 250,000 to 1.150 million. Now, given the high turnout in certain districts, it is reasonable to conclude that Khan won mainly because London's Muslims voted en bloc to elect their first mayor in any Western capital. Evidently, Muslim voters were not deterred from supporting Khan by the fact that he had shared platforms with radical Islamists, represented them in court, or otherwise associated himself with them and their views. Once elected, Khan reassured his core supporters by picking a fight over Islam with Donald Trump, of course, who hasn't even held office yet. One may well agree with Khan's view of Trump, probably the most hated man in the Muslim world right now, but should alienating a US presidential candidate really be the top priority for a new mayor of London? More worrying still, the mayoral election coincided with the anti-Semitism scandal in the Labour Party. It was set off by the former London mayor and Labour National Executive member Ken Livingstone, who, by claiming that Hitler had colluded with Zionists and shared their goal of a Jewish state, deliberately stoked up hatred of Israel and smeared Jews by extension. The resulting outcry put pressure on Corbyn, whose views on Zionism are indistinguishable from Livingstone's, and who has shared platforms with Hamas and Hezbollah. The Labour Party announced an independent inquiry into anti-Semitism within its ranks, but Corbyn made sure that it was chaired by a human rights activist, Shami Chakrabarty, who is not only a party member, but has no expertise in anti-Semitism and appears to want the scope of the inquiry to be broadened to include Islamophobia. The only Jew involved is an anti-Zionist academic. Sadiq Khan distanced himself from Livingstone's incendiary remarks, but given that polls suggest that up to half the Muslim community holds vehemently anti-Semitic views, the row may well have helped to get him elected. Once Khan was home and dry, he had himself photographed with the chief rabbi and attended a Holocaust memorial ceremony. The truth is that Corbyn, Livingstone, and Khan, like the rest of the left, are all implacably hostile to Israel. Given that for the overwhelming majority of Jews, Zionism is part of their identity, the denial of Israel's legitimacy as a Jewish state inevitably puts the left on a collision course, not only with Israelis, but also with the diaspora. This brings me to the main point about the left and the West. If the moral basis of the democratic right since 1945 was to preserve the free world from communism, that of the democratic left was to preserve it from a revival of Nazism. Anti-Semitism was the common factor in both forms of totalitarianism, in practice if not in theory. And so both right and left have a particular duty to expose and defeat anti-Semitism whenever and wherever it emerges. The post-war right, both in America and Europe, has not always been staunch in its support of the Jewish people in general and the Jewish state in particular, but at least since the era of Reagan and Thatcher, support for Israel and opposition to anti-Semitism in all its manifestations have been articles of faith for the majority of conservatives in the Anglosphere. Not so on the left. There, the demonization of Israel, and by extension of the Israel lobby, so-called, has tempted the liberal conscience into adopting the vocabulary and the agenda of anti-Semitism, from the Stop the War coalition after 9/11 to the Occupy and BDS movements more recently. Above all, the left has, thanks to its long-standing aversion to such slippery notions as imperialism, Orientalism, and of course capitalism, made common cause with radical Islam, which often presents itself in a revolutionary guise, as it did during the Arab Spring. The proposition that the West is responsible for most, if not all, of the misfortunes of the world has a perennial appeal to the liberal imagination. Once, it meant turning a blind eye to crimes committed by communist regimes and their proxies. Now, it has translated itself into an uncannily similar attitude to oppression in the Islamic world. This betrayal of the West, not unlike the flirtation with fascism of French intellectuals between the wars, which Julien Bender dubbed the trahison des clercs, goes far beyond a fringe phenomenon. Take, for example, the cult of Malcolm X, a racist and Islamist demagogue who has exercised a toxic influence on black communities ever since his assassination in 1965. Yet, is now canonized by white intellectuals. In a Thought for the Day talk given last month on BBC Radio 4's flagship Today program, which has up to 10 million listeners, Robert Beckford informed the British public that they should, quote, continue Malcolm's quest for race, class, and gender justice, unquote. Now, Professor Beckford holds a chair of theology and culture at Canterbury, the place where 1,420 years ago, an Italian monk called Augustine arrived on a mission from Pope Gregory the Great, converted Ethelbert, the Saxon king of Kent, to Christianity, and founded a monastery there. Thus, we have the irony that a Christian theologian in the birthplace of what would become the Ecclesia Anglicana uses the BBC's bully pulpit to promote the ideas of the founder of black power extremism, who taught that Christianity was the religion of white slave owners and is responsible, Malcolm X, is responsible for the spread of Islam among African Americans. A day later, St. Augustine's successor, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, denounced anti-Semitism as absolutely intolerable and a deep shame before a multi-faith audience that included the chief rabbi. A long overdue gesture, to be sure, even if he refused to single out the Labour Party or the left more generally. It is certainly far preferable to his immediate predecessor, Rowan Williams, who embraced the inevitability of Sharia law in Britain. But in the same breath as he anathematized anti-Semitism, Dr. Welby denied its uniquely evil influence by aligning it with Islamophobia. He dismissed fellow Christians who warn against the dangers posed by radical Islam and the fact that British Muslims lead parallel lives. What motivated the Archbishop was, we may assume, the fear of offending Muslims, who are responsible for much of the rise of anti-Semitism, and the very Anglican preference for a middle way, an aversion to upsetting consensus. This is not quite the spirit of another Archbishop of Canterbury, St. Thomas Becket, whose defiance of King Henry II cost him his life in 1170, when he was martyred in his own cathedral. Until the Reformation, Becket's shrine was one of the greatest places of pilgrimage in Christendom. It might be said to have given birth to modern English literature by providing the occasion for Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. When some of Becket's relics were brought back to Canterbury last month from Esztergom in Hungary, did it occur to the present Archbishop that one of the great sources of the Western political tradition has been the separation of church and state? Or that Becket died to preserve what he saw as the libertas ecclesiae, the freedom of the church from secular authority? Such a separation of mosque and state is alien to Islam. Even in Turkey, which has sought to imitate the West, political Islam has returned with a vengeance under Recep Tayyip Erdogan. Only in the West have liberty, democracy, and the rule of law been able to emerge, limiting the powers of both ecclesiastical and secular authorities. Modern Western political theory and practice were only forged in the furnace of the Enlightenment, the greatest legacy of which is the United States. But these freedoms have their origin in biblical ideas, without which our political tradition would be cut off from its taproot. Clerics such as Archbishop Welby would do better to attend to the precipitous collapse of Christianity. In the last 5 years only, the proportion in England describing themselves as having no religion has doubled from 25% to nearly 50%. What has changed is that those brought up as Christians are abandoning their given identity. London, as so often, is untypical. Nuns there, those with no religion, number only 40%. The reason is the high percentage of Muslims in the capital. The rapid hollowing out of English Christianity is mirrored elsewhere on the continent. But the self-immolation of the Judeo-Christian tradition in Europe would sound the death knell of the whole of Western civilization. As we have seen, neither the right nor the left is doing a good job of defending, representing, or embodying the values of our civilization. Those values come into play if, for example, the state treats human beings merely as a means rather than an end, or if executive authority is elevated above the law, or if the rights of conscience are subordinated to the sensibilities of groups or the imperatives of society. Conservatives are on guard against big government while being alert to any abdication of its proper responsibilities to individuals and families. Liberals have an overriding duty to protect the most vulnerable at home and abroad without allowing the entitlements of the living to burden generations as yet unborn. Our politics would still be recognizable to citizens of the Greco-Roman polis. We have not improved on the Enlightenment's injunction to be ready to make the supreme sacrifice for the sake of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, just as we still divine the moral law encoded in our hearts and enshrined in the Hebrew Bible. The story of the West is the exegesis of this incomparable, inexhaustible diamond mine of the intellect. The disjunction between left and right only enters this story during the French Revolution, when the seating arrangements of the Estates General proved more memorable than the deputies to be seated. That is where left and right actually come from, those seating arrangements. Yet the party antagonisms of liberals and conservatives, populists and elitists, progressives and traditionalists seemed to have usurped the political stage to the detriment of the defense of civilization itself. This has historically been less true in time of war or other emergencies. During the Second World War, the bitter and destructive hostilities between communist and bourgeois parties were temporarily suspended, at least in some of the Allies, in order to defeat Germany and Japan. Similarly, during the Cold War, adversarial politics between anti-communists of left and right was kept within bounds because of the common enemy in Moscow. That came to an end after 1989, since when the polarization of politics in America and Europe has only intensified. It has become commonplace, not only for Democrat and Republican or Labour and Conservative activists, but even for ordinary voters, to exclude anybody of the opposite persuasion from their circle of acquaintance. How very different, how utterly dismaying is such an uncharitable partisanship from the magnanimous spirit which once animated our great democracies. One example must suffice, that of Benjamin Disraeli. In his life of Lord George Bentinck, Britain's first and thus far only Jewish Prime Minister wrote a personal manifesto in the guise of a political biography. He actually coined that phrase. This was the first political biography. Disraeli defined his own conservatism as an expression of what he called the Semitic principle: religion, property, and natural aristocracy. His interpretation of Judaism was the antithesis of the orthodoxy that his father had already rejected when choosing to have the young Benjamin baptized. Indeed, Disraeli's Jewish religion was unique to him, and he devotes an entire chapter of the book to it. But the paradox that made Disraeli's extraordinary career possible was his leadership of the high Tory backwoodsman in the House of Commons after the early death of Bentinck, subject of the book. And the single fact that inspired Disraeli to throw in his lot with these dyed-in-the-wool reactionaries was Bentinck's decision to defy his faction of the Tories so that a Jewish MP for the City of London could take his seat without swearing a Christian oath. Disraeli concedes that Bentinck's motives had nothing to do with his own, but were, quote, in accordance with that general principle of religious liberty to which he was an uncompromising adherent, unquote. The point is that this principle, applied specifically to Jewish civil liberties, was capable of breaking up party or factional loyalties. Bentinck was rebelling against the rebels he had led against Sir Robert Peel over free trade and protection. So he was a rebel against the rebels. That sacrifice of career on a matter of principle was also capable of inspiring Disraeli, a man of profoundly liberal sensibilities, to join the most illiberal of the Tories. As a Conservative Prime Minister of a minority government, he would later persuade the Commons, with his incredible eloquence, to give the vote to working men, though he failed to persuade them to support John Stuart Mill's efforts to extend the franchise to women. That had to wait another 70 years. But he was generations ahead of his time. The Victorians invented modern party politics, but they elevated principle above party. Today, we find an almost total absence of solidarity across the democratic political spectrum against the threats that confront the West. Such magazines as Standpoint in London, The Weekly Standard in Washington, or Commentary in New York can do something to rebuild the alliance against anti-Western ideologies that the Cold Warrior generation sustained from the 1950s to the 1980s. Yet the enemies of the open society are far more subversive now than in those days. They invade our space, virtual as well as physical, with ease. They saturate us with propaganda, deploying traditional media such as broadcasting stations, social media, and every conceivable form of cyber warfare directed at the West. With terrifying rapidity, hostile foreign powers are buying into our institutions and corporations, our universities and cities, literally and metaphorically. They are thereby buying influence on our policies and our silence about their atrocities. Let there be no illusions about the malign intentions of our antagonists, external and internal. China, Russia, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and other authoritarian regimes are out to undermine the intellectual pillars of democratic capitalism. Meanwhile, our public opinion is seduced by the dream of a world without enemies, by the pathologies of relativism, cultural, moral, and epistemological, and by the need to fill the void created by ignorance of or hostility to the Judeo-Christian core of our civilization. I hesitate to adopt Disraeli's implicitly racial idiom, but he was not entirely mistaken when speaking of the early 19th century, a long time ago now, he observed that, quote, the decline and disasters of modern communities have generally been relative to their degree of sedition against the Semitic principle, unquote. By Semitic principle, he meant Judeo-Christian civilization. France has been in a, quote, a state of collapse or convulsion. Germany has never at any time been thoroughly converted. Spain has been in decline ever since the expulsion of the Jews. By contrast, England, notwithstanding her deficient and meager theology, has always remembered Zion. The great transatlantic republic, he means America, is intensely Semitic and has prospered accordingly. Disraeli may be one of the most peculiar paragons of philo-Semitism to feature in The People of the Book, Gertrude Himmelfarb's superb history. But he was astonishingly prescient, anticipating by nearly two centuries today's crisis of Judeo-Christian culture. Almost a century after Disraeli's dream of a Zionist return to Palestine became a reality with a declaration by his successor, Arthur Balfour, we might expect knowledge and appreciation of the Jewish contribution to civilization to be greater than ever before. Yet what Europe endorses, tacitly or overtly, is the BDS campaign. Not content to boycott, divest, and sanction Israel, it seeks to blacken, delegitimize, and slander the Jewish state. When Palestinians stab and terrorize Israeli civilians, the criticism is all of IDF soldiers. Spurious comparisons with the Nazis are reserved not for Abbas, who never condemns and always rewards the killers, but for Netanyahu. In The Spectator, the Scottish composer Sir James Macmillan asks some cogent questions about Europe. I quote him. After 1989, why have the European elites failed to denounce the immorality of communism? Why have the same elites supported the likes of Yasser Arafat and the Iranian governments? Why are extremist parties well supported? And why is anti-Americanism on the rise in Europe? Why do the European elites hate Christianity? Why is anti-Semitism on the rise on the European left? Why is Europe committing demographic suicide? Why does Europe look like it has given up hope in its future? Unquote. But if continental Europe is overrun by those whom Disraeli called the modern Attilas, what of the English-speaking peoples by whose fidelity to biblical principles he set such store? How Semitic is Obama's America? And does Sadiq Khan's England remember Zion? The diagnosis, surprisingly, is more complex than the cure. There are numerous viruses attacking the Western body politic, but only one medicine. To face the future unflinchingly, we must return to the past. Listen to the patriarchs and prophets, the ancestral voices of our literature. Break open the arsenal of our intellectual history, and mobilize the resources of righteous indignation against the dominions, principalities, and powers of darkness that threaten to overwhelm us. The great books, from Homer to Shakespeare, from Plato to Pascal, from Dante to Bello, must once again not only be assigned to every student, but learned where possible by heart. The music of the masters, from Gregorian chant to George Gershwin, from Sebastian Bach to James Macmillan, who I just quoted, from Palestrina to Arvo Pärt, must not only float across the courts and quads of our colleges, but fill our airwaves and headsets. The art and architecture of the West must not only fill our galleries and screens, but be protected from the vandals who threaten antiquities from Leptis Magna to Palmyra. In short, we must celebrate Western civilization as the living, breathing, flourishing organism that it is. Unless the coming generations embrace its treasures and make them their own, we will forfeit all that the children of Abraham have created to give glory to God, all that has ennobled the West and enabled the rest of humanity to be more humane. But a robust, self-confident culture alone is not enough. There must also be foreign and defense policies, muscular enough, not only to support the democratic, liberating, and civilizing mission of Western civilization, but also to keep that civilization safe from predators. Just as the Chinese communists and others have embraced the market, not to dismantle their totalitarian power structures, but only to reinforce them, so they are now adopting the cultural habits and artistic tastes of the West, while ignoring the religious roots of the laws and liberties that made such a civilization possible. And while the Islamists in general fear and abominate Western culture, or even wish to extirpate it because they sense its power, there is always a danger that our political will may be insufficient to resist the demographic pressures now being brought to bear in Europe. I'm speaking of France, in which a quarter of teenagers are already Muslims, or England, which within a generation may have followed the example of its capital, where the, quote, white British, this is the technical term, self-describing white British, are now a rapidly dwindling minority in London. Europe's migration crisis is not a crisis. It is, as the novelist Lionel Shriver aptly put it to me, the new normal. One does not need to have an iota of sympathy for Donald Trump's crude discrimination against Muslims, or even advocate the mass repatriation of illegal migrants. By the time he leaves office, Barack Obama will have deported nearly 3 million of them, more than all other presidents since 1892 combined. You don't hear that statistic very often, but you know, that's what Obama has done. So, you know, deporting illegal migrants is not only a conservative policy, but you don't even have to advocate that to see that the numbers now entering Europe and America are impossible to integrate. If Western civilization is to survive, the mobilization of mankind in pursuit of prosperity on a scale that dwarfs anything seen before, we shall have to restore the borders we've been striving to abolish for decades. It is not illiberal to make secure borders the quid pro quo for generous treatment of refugees. Israel, which has no choice but to keep its borders secure, is a nation of immigrants. Maybe in this respect, as in others, Jews can be a light for the Gentiles. Will Western civilization, which has endured the vicissitudes of millennia, survive this century? If those of us who care enough resolve to make that civilizational survival our highest goal, dedicating the best efforts of our free peoples to renewing that sense of moral purpose and intellectual curiosity we have lost over the last generation, then the inner strength that enabled us to win the Cold War will carry us through again. There is a bright future for us, given peace and security, a new golden age of science, philosophy, and the arts could dawn, combining a renaissance of the West with a global enlightenment. A generation from now, it is possible to envisage a world in which, thanks to the spread of Western ideas and technology, not only tens of millions, but billions of people are able to enjoy, with Matthew Arnold and the rest of the West, quote, the best that is known and thought in the world, unquote, without the interference of their politburos and potentates, their warlords and guardians. Is there, though, that awakening consciousness of the precarious nature of civilization which Churchill conjured up so vividly in the speeches with which he roused the free world against the Nazi menace in 1940? Without such a spur to action, the restoration of Western morale may remain a mere desideratum rather than a fact. Only those who know what it is to live in exile under the yoke of servitude can teach others what tyranny is and what is needed to overcome it. May the leaders of the West, whether they hail from the right or the left, reach deep into our collective memory, resurrecting and drawing on the bitter experience of an exiled nation. In Psalm 137, perhaps the most memorable of all, the psalmist sings, by the waters of Babylon, we sat down and wept, when we remembered thee, O Zion. As for our harps, we hanged them up upon the trees that are therein. For they that led us away captive required of us then a song and melody in our heaviness. Sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If we were to forget the origins of the West here, in this great city of God, our right hands too would forget their cunning. The conservative cause, the right hand of politics, the conservative cause would be lost, and the machinery of capitalism would grind to a halt. Our harps too would fall silent as the cultural achievements of the centuries lost their meaning. If the Bible is the testament of the human race, the Jewish people is the living embodiment of that collective memory. The West's commitment to Israel's existence is or should be a matter of self-interested survival. We stand or fall together. Thank you.
I'll just make a few comments after that far-ranging and erudite and inspiring and very, very interesting and thought-provoking talk, which I really don't disagree at all. So it allows me to be very brief and leave some time for us to have maybe a conversation and some questions. I guess I'll make three points. I actually had been enjoying my 3 days in Israel and enjoying the spectacle of watching Israelis grapple with their political problems and not thinking about Donald Trump. And Daniel ruined that by discussing Donald Trump at some length. So now I have to think about that on the plane back, which is very distressing. I'll say a word about Trump, since I guess I ought to. It's a pretty major phenomenon. I mean, people, it's not a happy one, and it's extremely unusual. It really, and in that respect, I do think it could just be an odd thing, you know, black swan, as we say, a strange concatenation of events that led to this man winning the nomination of one of the two major parties and leading to a choice that I think is an extremely uninspiring choice, to say the least, between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton as the almost certain Democratic nominee. But it also is startling. I mean, neither party in the United States has ever nominated someone like Trump, neither major party. And I don't mean that in a judgmental way. I just mean that analytically. In America, with very few exceptions, the major parties have nominated someone who has held elective office, either a governor or a senator, very rarely a congressman, very often a vice president, occasionally a general. That's usually a successful war general like Dwight Eisenhower. No American president, there's never been an American president who wasn't a general, a cabinet secretary, or a senator, or governor, or congressman before that. So it's very unusual. Some countries are more accustomed to nominating, you know, rich businessmen who are colorful, or people who are on a television, have television shows and all, but that hasn't, and America's done that a lot for lower offices, but rarely, never elected anyone president like that, and very rarely, there are really three or four such cases in the whole history of the two major parties of a nominee like that. And those nominees were much different, very well-established lawyers who were consensus candidates after contested conventions in 1924 and 1940 and so forth. So just analytically, the phenomenon of Trump may suggest we're in a new era for various reasons of media, technology, popular unhappiness, elites being out of touch with the public, whatever. Or it might just be that this was just an odd year, 17 candidates, they made mistakes, Trump got lucky, Trump was a very skillful candidate and demagogue. The Republican Party was really unhappy to have been sort of outmaneuvered by Obama. Bush was the front runner at the beginning, and he was, the last thing most Republicans wanted was another Clinton-Bush race. That's, you know, after you've had failed politics for 10 or 20 years, or at least what's seen to be as failed politics, the last thing you want is the wife of one former president and the brother, son and brother of another former president as your nominees. So I think people did think the system was broken, the system was failing to produce new leaders, and they went sort of outside the system for a leader. The trouble, and I think that's I'm very sympathetic to that instinct. I was sympathetic to much of the populist unhappiness with elites left and right. But unfortunately, you can be unhappy, and you can be angry, and you can be justified in your anger. But history shows, and I would say personal life shows too, right? You can be justly angry at someone, but you can still do something foolish as a result of your anger. And that, I think, is the situation the Republican Party has put itself in. The election, if you came down from Mars and looked at the American election, you would see there are three candidates left. A socialist, Bernie Sanders, who's learned nothing, honestly, in 50 years about economics or public policy. And I don't mean that, again, pejoratively. I mean, he would say that, too. He hasn't changed his mind about anything. You know, the Soviet Union has fallen. Socialist policies have not worked terribly well. China and India have taken a billion people out of poverty by moving from state control towards versions, at least, of free markets. And he's oblivious to that, pretty much. So we have a socialist running. We have Hillary Clinton, really an epitome of a kind of insider, crony, somewhat corrupt, you know, family. Politics is the family business, and you get rich off the family business. You have instances like that here in Israel, I would say. Most democracies have people and families like that. So we have one candidate like that. And we have the populist, authoritarian demagogue. Now, if you came down from Mars, as I say, and said, what does this election look like? This looks like a third world election. This is literally what Argentinian elections look like, right? There's a socialist, there's an authoritarian populist who's often very rich and good at exploiting grievances, and there's usually an insider, crony, you know, family member of some previous president who has a lot of unexplained money from his or her time in office. And one thing Americans have always prided themselves on, I would say, this is what American exceptionalism means in part, you know, is that our politics was a little different. We didn't produce great presidents every time. We didn't produce great leaders. We have our own problems, God knows. But sort of that kind of election is really what one expects to see in Latin America, or maybe in Eastern Europe, or in various places that Americans have tended to look down on rather than think was our future. So it is, I mean, that is why I think people are unnerved, and why, I mean, some people like me are against Trump because you don't think he should be president. That's not a very complicated argument. What you might have to do in October in terms of voting, if we don't succeed in getting a good independent candidate, which I think we might, but nonetheless, if that were to happen, that's another question also. But leaving aside the choices one has to make as a citizen and thinking forward, I think that's why the election's a little more unnerving than a typical election where you get choices you're not thrilled about, but they're within the bounds of kind of normal American party politics, I would say. You don't think it's necessarily an indictment of the system. President Obama turned out to be a bad president. John McCain wasn't a great candidate running against him. Mitt Romney turned out to be a kind of a poor national candidate because he was rich and couldn't answer the charges against him. But I don't think having Obama or McCain or Romney run for president, be nominated for president, is a particular indictment of, you know, American politics. They're all serious, respectable men of considerable achievement in certain ways. Obama, the most questionable, but there it was the first African American really mattered a lot. And, you know, you can't really blame people for wanting to have that historic first. So I do think this election is different and unnerving and worrisome about what it says about America. Okay, enough about Trump. Second point I would make is the current moment in terms of, I guess the title of Daniel's talk was The Future of Western Civilization. Some of it was about the decline of Western civilization. People have worried about that a long time, not foolishly. But it is worth remembering that it's very hard to predict the future, as Daniel himself says and knows. And there have been times when everyone agreed that things were falling apart and going rapidly downhill, and there were pretty quick reversals and pretty surprising reversals. And generally speaking, I think these days, we think we can forecast history too well. Of course, we can't even forecast a presidential primary, it turns out. I was as wrong as anyone about Trump. There are these amazing reversals and surprises in history. And then they happen, they surprise everyone. 5 years later, everyone decides, well, of course that happened. That was inevitable, you know? I mean, whether it's, I was thinking about this 100 years ago, today, great battles of World War I, horrible battles, terrible battles of World War I were happening. And if you had given a talk here or anywhere else and said that within a year and a half, Russia would be taken over by the Communist Party, by the Bolsheviks, and then would be ruled for, 70 years by that party, and that would become a defining aspect of world politics. No one believed that. I mean, they were communists were a party, but no one thought they would take over a major country, govern it successfully, as it were, or at least continue to hold it, end up taking over a huge swath of neighboring countries, take over China. And again, there are a million, of course, examples like that where no one would have predicted anything that had happened in the 20th century. Afterwards, Tocqueville has a brilliant analysis of this in Democracy in America, which I recommend. In democratic times, historians want to say that everything that happens had to have happened. And they want to say that because that minimizes human choice and human agency and the importance of particular decisions. And because the way we think in democracies tends to be that there are these huge forces, inevitable forces, historical waves, and we are just bobbing along. There's a certain kind of egalitarianism to that. That's sort of what happens in a mass democracy, the way people tend to think more in a mass democracy. But it's not true, really. Individuals make a huge difference. Surprises happen. In the mid-70s, many of people thought, not without reason, that we were really on a steep decline. British politics were in awful shape. American politics seemed to be in awful shape. We had a president forced from office under the threat of impeachment for the first time in 1974. We'd lost Vietnam in a really kind of disgraceful and dishonorable way, I would say, pulled out in 75, having pulled out in 72 with a promise to come back if the North Vietnamese attacked. We didn't come back, and we had to evacuate our embassy, those famous photos in 75. Carter becomes president in 76, our foreign policy is in shambles, Iran, heretofore a sort of bastion of friendly nation to Israel and to America, is taken over by the mullahs in 79. I mean, think of those years. And yet, things turned around, at least at some level, pretty quickly and very unexpectedly. And it really is, I'll just take a minute on it, but the main point, and one point I would make is how unexpected it was. You know, people think always you're in the middle of a situation, you think you sort of have seen things before, you can tell where things are going. The truth is, if in 1975 someone had predicted that by 1990, which is only 15 years, it's not that long, that's as long as it's been since 9/11, for example, or since the Second Intifada, right? In 15 years, that there would have been a reversal in foreign policy, the Soviet Union would have fallen, socialism would be fairly well discredited, India and China, India about to, China already, would be on the road towards a kind of capitalist economies, taking hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. Or more precisely, if you'd predicted in 75 that Margaret Thatcher, an obscure backbench cabinet officer in the opposition, would defeat the former prime minister, defeat it for the party leadership in 75, defeat the Labour Prime Minister in 79, become the first woman Prime Minister of Great Britain, serve for 11 years, and turn the British economy around. If you had predicted that, I mean, no one predicted that. Ronald Reagan lost in 76, too old to run again, people thought, too conservative, much too right-wing, never would be president, maybe could get nominated, would certainly lose, gets nominated, wins the election. Very successful presidency for 8 years. His vice president gets nominated after him. We win the Cold War. And Pope John Paul II, incidentally. Pope dies. Pope had served over a decade, dies in, what, October of 78, I think it was, September of 78. Another Italian pope is elected October of 1978. There have been only Italian popes for 450 years. He dies after a month as pope in a kind of very unusual moment. The cardinals elect a Polish cardinal as pope, the first non-Italian pope, as I say, in almost 500 years. He turns out to be an unbelievably important historical figure. Leave aside the theology, though he's important in that way too, and important actually for the Jews and for Israel in terms of Catholicism and really Protestantism, I would say. Protestantism's attitude too, because the Catholic change on the Jews influenced the Protestants. But also he goes to Poland in the summer of 1980, says, be not afraid, and really begins the unraveling of the Soviet Empire, which happens in a decade. So Thatcher, Reagan, and the Pope, Pope John Paul II, dominate the decade of the 80s. They're all in power for almost the whole 80s. They're the three leading figures on the world stage. No one expects them. I mean, you could have won. I can't even imagine what the odds would have been if you had walked into Las Vegas in 1975 and said, I'd like to bet on the proposition that Margaret Thatcher, Ronald Reagan, and Cardinal Wojtyla are going to be the three dominant figures of the next decade, and that the Soviet Union will go in 1989, and that capitalism will be ascended. It's got its problems, but again, we don't understand enough how important that what Reagan did in that respect was too. Reagan's economic success is usually portrayed as an American success, but it was a global success, Reagan and Thatcher. I mean, it had a big difference over here, obviously, had a big difference in the East, and it really has, I mean, we can argue what we want about inequality and unfairness and the problems of capitalism today, but it's a very impressive moral achievement to take hundreds of millions, that's probably really more than a billion people at this point, out of real starvation and poverty, and give them a chance at a decent life. So nothing to be minimized. I mean, none of that was expected. None of that was expected. So it's a good reminder, things can turn fast, they can turn in unexpected ways. The people who turn things tend to be outsiders. They tend to be people often who come from different groups almost than the insiders who prevailed so far. I'd say this is somewhat true of Israel too, where I remember visiting Israel in 79, I think. So Begin had been elected a year and a half before. And people were getting used to it by 79. But again, we now take it for granted that Likud is strong, the right tends to win Israeli elections. You know, it was amazing when Begin won in 77. And people thought either it would be a catastrophe or some people thought it would be a new dawn for Israel. It was really neither, but it was a big surprise and actually ultimately a pretty impressive thing for very important for Israel to have a peaceful transfer of power, obviously, from one party, which rules for 30 years, to another. Just one last thing on surprises, since I'm in Israel. I'll just take a second. I mean, I was in the Bush White House, the first Bush White House in 1991, and there was a very nasty fight, 92, and a nasty fight between the Bush administration and the Shamir administration about loan guarantees. Loan guarantees to pay for the absorption of a million Russian refugees who were coming at the end of the Soviet Union. Why were these needed? Why were people so alarmed about this? Leave aside the fight, which was about whether the U.S. would pay, you know, in effect guarantee the loans and therefore allow for a better interest rate for the Israeli government. Why were people so alarmed about this? People thought this was, they were luck, they were happy to have, of course, all these, this was the point of Israel, was to take in Jews from around the world, so no one was complaining about it. But privately, people thought this is a disaster. I mean, serious people, good people too, not out of any ill will. They just thought, we have to absorb a million people who don't speak the language, who don't really have, haven't shown that much interest, honestly, in Judaism or in Israel. The refuseniks were one thing, but most of them had come out, you know, earlier, and that was a very small number, really. And then just have this mass of people, some of them really weren't Jews, at least halakhically, probably, you know, it's still an issue, I guess. Most of, you know, there are a lot of fantastic concert pianists and chess players, and, but what are they going to do for a living in Israel? There are only so many symphony orchestras you can have, you know. And people were really panicked about it, and it wasn't stupid of them. I mean, these were intelligent people thinking, what do we, you know, how, countries, it's very hard for a country to absorb an additional 20%, 15% of a population, again, not speaking the language, et cetera. And I think most analysts would agree now that it was a very good thing for the state of Israel. Demographically, economically, the absorption has been much less problematic than people thought. You know, in all kinds of ways, it's been very good, I think, for the Jewish people and for the state of Israel. Again, a very good instance, and I'm not sure it was because anyone pursued any brilliant policies either. It just turned out that things worked out in certain ways that people didn't expect. So it's a good lesson that things often don't go the way you expect. They often go the opposite way, almost. Sometimes they go worse, you know. No one expected Hitler to come to power in the most sophisticated, advanced nation in Europe. Fantastic educational system. Most flourished, the Jewish community that was most probably integrated and that was had flourished the most in any nation in Europe. So things can be horrible. They're horrible surprises and they're happy surprises, but there are surprises. And those surprises aren't just random, though. They are due to the actions of people, you know, leaders, and groups of people, and institutions that are set up intelligently, or reforms that allow for institutions and incentives and the rule of law and so forth. So we again underestimate, I think, the degree to which we can control our future by making these choices, by electing the right people, even given the limits of what we can forecast. Final point. Daniel really discussed this very eloquently at the end. It is sort of an amazing mystery why Israel and the Jews are so central to Western civilization. They have been for an awful long time. Charles Krauthammer has a wonderful essay written 15 years ago on the centrality of Israel to Judaism now in the current world, in the post-Shoah, post-Israel, post-1948 world, and making the point that, and now I think for the first time, a close to a majority, isn't it, about half of Jews worldwide live in Israel, actually, and it's a huge change, obviously, from the way things used to be. And everyone really acknowledges that the future of Israel is key to the future of Judaism. Charles goes further in a way that many wouldn't agree with and says that he's not sure Judaism could survive if Israel didn't survive, and it's a terrible risk, in a way, to have everyone in one place, despite how wonderful the IDF is, and et cetera, because, you know, as Iran likes to say, it's a one-bomb nation here and so forth. So it's a very unusual moment. The dispersion and weakness of the Jews did in some way guarantee the existence, continued existence, you could argue, of the Jewish people, and in a way the coming together is highly risky. But that point is less important, interesting, I think, than the point Daniel makes, which is somehow the Israel has become central to the fate of the West, the fate of not just Christianity or even the secular West, even just the Enlightenment West. Israel really stands, I think, for the modern, liberal, Western, enlightened, but also friendly to religious world. It's under attack. The attacks that have come against Israel have been followed by similar attacks against other nations that have similar values and principles. Eric Hoffer saw this, the American longshoreman philosopher, right after 67. He had a very eloquent statement in 1968 when people were already turning anti-Israel. People forget how quickly that happened after 67, and Israel was the Goliath, not the David, and so forth. And Hoffer said that this is on the survival of Israel depends our survival. It's not just about being nice to the Jews, or it's not that they deserve to have a state because of the Holocaust, or that they shouldn't be attacked by terror attacks. It's really our survival that's at stake. And I think it's a little bit of a mystery why that is, and why that's been so for, as Disraeli says, why it's sort of a test of a civilization, how it treats the Jews, and how the Jews fare, and how I think the state of Israel fares. But I think that is as true today as it's ever been. So those are my remarks, and maybe Daniel wants to make a couple of comments, and then we'll just take a few questions, and then we'll see if our delayed plane is actually leaving. Yeah?
I don't have very much to add to what Bill said, because he said it so well, and as he always does. It will not have escaped your notice that I did mention both his father and his mother in my speech. And, Bill comes from...
I would have been much tougher if he hadn't, you know.
he does come from very good stock. As long as America is still producing people like Bill Kristol, then all hope is not lost. Someone was saying to me, Rabbi Pfeffer actually was saying to me on the way here that the point about Trump is he doesn't like ideas. He cannot bear ideas. Well, fortunately, there are a lot of people in America who do care about ideas and who care about the battle of ideas. The battle of ideas is what Tikvah is all about. That's why we're here tonight, I think, all of us, because we care about ideas, and that is what sustains. It's the fuel that drives a civilization. Let's have some ideas from you.
I've just written down what Daniel said so kindly, that so I can tweet that out at Donald Trump. You know, as long as America still—it's not true—but as long as America still produces people like Bill Kristol, all is not lost. I think that could really, like, he could change his mind. Don't you think? After
is Brexit a solution to sealing borders again to protect British civilization?
I'll repeat the question: is Brexit the answer to sealing borders and saving British civilization? Well, I hope nobody misunderstood me.
Brexit is the vote on June 23rd about whether Britain would leave the European Union.
The referendum, exactly. Now, I'm not advocating sealing borders. You know, there are one or two very authoritarian prime ministers in Eastern Europe who I think have almost literally sealed their borders. Of course, I don't believe in that. You know. Of course, as Bill said, you know, great nations live on absorbing the best, that immigrants have to offer. And, you know, this nation of Israel wouldn't exist but for that. Britain wouldn't exist if at various points in our history we hadn't had a new influx from all over the world. But I do think that having secure borders is what democracies in the modern world require, because secure borders mean that people can feel confident that those who come, and they can be numerous or not so numerous at different times, are committed to the values that make that society what it is. And it's not unreasonable to expect refugees and other migrants to obey the laws and to more than just obey the laws, but actually support what the country's about. You know, you don't, for example, have to be Jewish to live in Israel, but you have to, I think, accept that it's a Jewish state. You know, that's what Israel is. And anyone who rejects that probably should go and live somewhere else. You know, it's anyone who wants to live in Britain should accept Britain, you know, with our history and our culture and everything else that makes us British. And that is what has been lost in Europe, because the abolition of internal borders in Europe means that people can come, whether or not they, you know, they support that country's values, and sometimes they really don't. Obviously, international terrorism, particularly Islamist terrorism, has brought this to a head. You know, we are all very nervous about that, And, you know, when I came into Israel a few days ago, Ben Gurion, quite rightly, I was asked a lot of questions at both ends, you know, about why I was here and what I was doing and who I was and who'd invited me. That's what a normal country does. That's quite proper. There's nothing to be ashamed of about that. But until we in Britain can re-establish secure borders, I think politics will continue to be poisoned by this issue, actually. It is a toxic issue, and it can breed extremism of left and right. Now, whether we need to leave Europe in order to regain control of our borders, that's a rather drastic step. You know, there are many arguments for staying in Europe that have nothing to do with that. But, I mean, Standpoint has deliberately not told its readers either to vote to leave or to remain. You know, we accept that our readers are divided, that there are very good arguments on both sides. So I'm not going to break, you know, my editorial omerta this evening by telling you which way I'm going to vote. All I am going to say, though, is that there are very, very strong reasons why people in Britain do want, among many other things, control of their borders. And I don't think they should be ashamed of that.
I can tell you that Daniel's going to vote to leave.
In the interest of just transparency.
Next question. Yes.
First of all, Daniel, thank you very much for this very thought-provoking and I would say also somewhat disconcerting talk. And if I were to try something more conceptual, I want to try and ask you something and challenge you perhaps a little bit on the notion of what to do with all of this. If I were to take just perhaps two themes from what you've said, so you spoke about the disappearing, well, you spoke about the phenomena of a new era of politics, and whether we know how to explain it or not, Trump, Poland, Sanders, it's, as you've said, it's a little bit about rebellion, and it's about rebelling against institutions, and in many ways rebelling against values and old infrastructures. If it's about new Western heroes like Assange, or hidden by the Russians because they're able to bring something out of the old institutions and sort of make a mockery of it. And then you spoke about the disappearing voice of God in Europe. And I mean, I've read somewhere that I think about 20 years, Sweden, there was some poll saying that from going from 82% to say that God is important in their life to 18. And that, I believe, even if it's challenged by the phenomena of refugees and Muslims coming to Europe, some of that response is translated into radical right and nationalism rather than to another sort of a mainstream voice of religion. And if that is the case, and you're saying, okay, well, let's stick to the Western civilization, let's stick to the values, let's stick to the old ideas, let's speak about Athens, and let's speak about, you know, the old Western philosophy. I just wonder if it's enough. I wonder if this is, if there's perhaps a sense of a new idea or a new thinking, or whether we're going to stick to what we know as old Western civilization will be a good conceptual answer to the challenge we face now.
Well, I did think long and hard about, you know, what to say about a cure for the diagnosis that I presented. And I honestly don't think that some novel philosophy or religion, you know, is going to save the West. I think that, I believe this very deeply, that the only way in which a civilization survives is by constantly renewing its past, you know, drawing on the resources of the past to make the present and the future live. It seems to me that, you know, young people, most of the people in this room are young, need to rediscover what is actually there. You know, most people now do not read very many books. They don't necessarily listen to good music. They don't necessarily absorb the best art and architecture. They need to do that. That should be part of everybody's daily life. You know, it needs to be much more than just a kind of occasional recreation. It needs to be something that you actually live for. And what lies behind that, of course, are religious values. You know, that is where the art and the music and the philosophy and the literature all come from. You cannot understand any of the great writers or the great music if you don't know anything about religion. You know, I have a daughter who I'm very proud of, who is teaching in a very difficult school in London where 40 languages are spoken, most of the pupils are Muslim. She has to teach Shakespeare and Milton. You know, she has to explain what Paradise Lost is all about to people who have no conception of the Bible. You know, they literally don't know anything about it. But you've got to do that. You've got to take that challenge and meet it. I think that New Age philosophies and, you know, attempts to sort of... I mean, look what the universities did since the 1970s with their post-modernist and post-this, post-that, post-constructionist, deconstructionist ideas. None of these ideas have lasted. None of them. They will all pass away and be of antiquarian interest for future generations. None of them has inspired people in the way that the great thinkers of Western civilization did in the past. It is a new scholasticism, which is even worse, much worse actually, than the medieval original scholasticism. And so if the universities have failed, then they have failed generations of young people. And that must change. You know, our universities, our media, our publishers, our public, our leaders need to set an example. You know, I quoted Disraeli, I quoted Churchill. These statesmen were deeply read, deeply steeped in the civilization of their day. And in at least at some level, they were all religious. You know, they may not have actually gone to church or synagogue, but they certainly knew their Bible. Their very language came from the Bible. And the Bible was once the most read book in Europe. It's now the least read book outside, of course, you know, yeshivas and places where people do still read it. But
they don't read the Bible. They read the Talmud, but that's okay.
Well, all right, okay, they read the Talmud. But the point I'm trying to make is that you know, on our libraries, in our universities and our public libraries, there are the Bibles gathering dust. You know, that's a tragedy, and that is something we can turn around.
I'll add one word. This is such a fantastically rare chance for me to be more liberal than someone else whom I'm appearing with slightly. Daniel, I think, will agree with what I'm about to say, but it's just the flip side of what he was saying. But every time that old ideas have been brought back to life, the Renaissance most fantastically, but also the Enlightenment and Lincoln with the Declaration of Independence, they've been renewed and recast and put in a new way and adjusted to new times. And obviously, and if you think politics, the origin of modern conservatism is Edmund Burke. What did Edmund Burke do for most of his political life? He reformed the administrative system of Britain. He insists he wished to be change the treatment of the U.S. and was sympathetic to the American Revolution, actually, as opposed to King George. I mean, so the degree, he wanted to reform, make sure that if Britain was to have an empire, which he was fine with, that it was governed in a civilized way, and he spent 7 years trying to impeach this fellow Warren Hastings, who was a arbitrary and sort of a kleptocratic, I guess, a ruler of India. So I think, yes, reform and conservatism can go hand in hand and do go intelligently hand in hand, but I think the point would be that simply trying to get beyond the history, beyond the past, is both foolish and dangerous. And I think that maybe the deepest case for Britain leaving the EU is that that is in a way the European Union is it is that is in a way what the European Union stands for. They had a very bad history. Well, they had a very great history, Europe. Then they had a very bad history for about 30 or 40 years in the 20th century. And they decided, rather than deciding, well, what's needed is to rethink in a serious way how to have stable political institutions, how to defeat extremism, how to have strong nation states at peace. They did some of that thinking. And Adenauer and the early leaders in the 50s, late 40s and 50s, really thought a lot about this, and even de Gaulle, despite his occasional, you know, going off in odd directions, was a great leader in this way. But then now the EU has become post-history, post-religion, living in a fantasy world where you never need to have military, contemptuous, of history and religion, and patriotism. And I think that would be the case for Britain leaving the EU would be that a British departure could revive a kind of healthy liberal nationalism, a healthy kind of patriotism, as British patriotism almost always was, which was also outward oriented and tried to foster liberal values elsewhere in the world. a healthy kind of religion, religious respect for religion, which could be respect from outside or a kind of respect from inside, which is not intolerant or fanatical. I just want to let Daniel mention Churchill. I guess Churchill's famous line about the Church of England was, someone said, why don't you ever go to church, basically. And Churchill said, I'm a huge strong supporter of the Church of England. I'm not a pillar of the Church of England, you know, that holds the church up from within. I'm one of the buttresses that hold it up from outside. And so I think at least our statesmen like Churchill, who were not, you know, pious, I wouldn't say, had an understanding that this was terribly important. As, on the other hand, he and Disraeli were great advocates for tolerance. Very important, the tolerance of Catholics, tolerance of Jews, in terms of coming into Parliament and so forth. So, and in the case of Churchill, a great Zionist, actually. So I think one can combine the spirit of reform and the spirit of conservatism.
I wanted to know, why is religion is being forgotten in Europe while America is seems to be more flourishing? There's quite a bit of difference between the two continents.
Yeah, I mean, there's a huge history there, obviously. I mean, Tocqueville remarks, partly through good luck and partly through a kind of statesmanship, you might say, of both the political and religious leaders, America had more successfully than Europe combined what he called the spirit of freedom and the spirit of religion. And the tragedy of Europe, and especially of France, which is Tocqueville's country, he thought was that the spirit of freedom in the French Revolution had been, for understandable reasons, almost perhaps, had been so hostile to the old regime, of which a key part was the church, that you now had these two forces in Europe, and he thought you could not have very unlikely to have a flourishing liberal democracy, flourishing nation, without more of a mixing of the spirit of religion and the spirit of freedom. So I think America has had some luck in the way it was settled. I think it turned out that the relative separation of church and state perhaps was better than having a state church, and it allowed religious revivals to happen. But I would also say and caution, about 10 to 15 years ago, a lot of us conservatives in America who were friendly to religion were sort of making this point and saying, well, Europe's in horrible shape, entirely secular, what civilization's ever really worked that way? America has a healthier mix of secular and religious. But the numbers are pretty astonishing in the last 10, 15 years in America as well, actually. The decline of church going, the number of young people who say they have no religious belief, some of that changes when you get older and stuff. But so it makes, maybe Americans were a little too confident and complacent about some of the ways in which religion was strong in America. But these things, I'll just finish by saying this. I mean, I said before, there are these surprises and changes. Religion is really a case study of that. You know what I mean? The degree to which religious revivals come out of nowhere, ages are utterly secular and decadent, and then are followed by ages that are much more religious. This is true within great religions, of course. It happens within Christianity. It certainly happens within Judaism. You could have lost a lot of money betting on the different, you know, the consensus in 1950 was in America, Orthodox, of course, fade away. Who wants to be Orthodox anymore in the modern world? But conservative Judaism, maybe, and Reform Judaism, certainly, they're going to be the flourishing parts of Judaism in 2016. And again, these weren't stupid people, you know, and they had arguments, and there was a lot about modernity that would have pushed you in that direction. And that turned out to be the opposite of the truth. And you have a lot of political debates here about the ultra-Orthodox or the Haredi, but again, analytically, one of the most unbelievable facts of the last 70 years has been the survival and flourishing, I think you'd have to say, of a group of Jews who, most of whom were killed, who seemed to be entirely from another era, who had to move to either an extremely modern country, America, or to Israel, basically, which had no particular hospitality, I think one could say, for them. I mean, they had a connection to Israel, but it wasn't being settled by their kind of people, mostly, you know? And then 70 years later, you look up, and it's a larger community than it was, you know, by many, many, by a long shot, than it was 50 or 60 or 70 years ago. And in fact, I think you could even argue there's a kind of intellectual renaissance, maybe, in that community. So it's a good reminder that these things go in very unpredictable directions.
Could I just add a brief word? I mean, Bill's, of course, absolutely right. And those are the classic arguments for why American religion has flourished while European hasn't.
But I just wanted to make a slightly different point, which is that when religion leaves the stage, what you get instead is political religion. There was a great Austrian thinker who moved to America to escape the Nazis called Erich Voeglin, and he wrote about this very brilliantly. And I remember discovering his writing on this at about the same time that the Ayatollah Khomeini issued his fatwa against Salman Rushdie in 1989. And that was the beginning, in some ways, of the whole campaign to close down free speech and the free press, the free movement of ideas, not just in the Muslim world, but in the West as well. And look how far we've come since then, you know, the murder of the Charlie Hebdo journalists and so on. Now, it seems to me that Islamism, if one can distinguish between Islam proper and Islamism, which is very problematic and scholars argue endlessly about it, but there is such a thing as a political religion, and this is it. Nazism was a political religion. That was what Voeglin was worried about. But communism as well, in its various manifestations, has often taken on religious characteristics. And these intensely political ideologies are what very often replace traditional religion. And that's incredibly dangerous, obviously. I mean, it's so dangerous and it's so obviously dangerous that you wonder why it keeps on happening. We keep letting this happen. Generations don't always learn the lessons of the previous generation. And I can only hope that Europe will save itself from succumbing to one or another political religion in the next few decades. Because sure as anything, you know, if Judeo-Christian civilization retreats, something else will take its place. Something will fill that vacuum. And it may not be very nice. And it may not be very good for this country, for Israel. I mean, we're already seeing how the more secular, the more postmodern Europe becomes, again, Bill spoke very eloquently about that, the more hostile to Israel it seems to be. Whether for that reason or for other reasons, this seems to be a steady progression. And that's, I'm afraid, another reason why I think the British might be wise to remember that thing that happened 100 years ago, the Balfour Declaration, without which we wouldn't be sitting here today, you know, that was one of those noble gestures that occasionally the British people have been capable of in their history. And I would like to see that happen again later this month.
Thank you.